I am Hamad Gabri, and I'd like to introduce some basic concepts for hadronic fracture propagation. Hadronic fracturing propagation is one of the most complicated process in oil and gas industry, and the main stimulation method for the shale gas boom and the tight formation. So I think any oil and gas industry person should learn or understand the hadronic fracturing generally, and how the well produced after hadronic fracturing. So let's take some basic concepts or some basic points about hadronic fracturing. So today we will talk about what's hadronic fracturing, what is the terminology of hadronic fracturing geometry, what is the concept of net pressure, and what is the fracture propagation direction, and how to understand the fracture propagation from net pressure, and we'll take a look about fracturing modeling. So what is the hadronic fracturing? Hadronic fracturing simply is to inject fluid with high rate to create a fracture in formation to increase the productivity and bypass near bore damage. For sure, when we drill any well and start to produce from it, we have, due to production, due to drilling, due to any operation on our well, we have damage around the near bore. So the operation that bypass that damage and create the conductive bath for this neural bore area and increase the contact area with our reservoir is hadronic fracturing. Simply, it create a fracture with conductivity higher than the conductivity of that area, that neural bore area, and increase the contact area with our reservoir. Why we need hadronic fracturing? Simply if we have a neural bore area that suffer from formation damage, we can bypass this formation damage or area by hadronic fracturing. In tight formation, we increase the contact area between reservoir and our well, so it increases the productivity. If we have well bore stability issue, like sand production in areas that suffer from sand production, we can make hadronic fracturing to minimize drawdown to increase the well bore stability. If we have a reservoir with a natural fracturing system, we can connect all this natural fracturing system around the well bore with 300 feet. We can with hadronic fracturing. So there is a lot of targets of hadronic fracturing. But also we need to keep in mind hadronic fracturing is not always good. Hadronic fracturing is good when the solution is hadronic fracturing. Hadronic fracturing, if it's not designed well or doesn't meet the design target, it will waste your money. At least one hadronic fracture job cost $500,000, which is cost impact on your budget, and and may cause less production than no fracture case. So it's like a medicine. When you take a medicine with no need, you maybe you get hurt to by this medicine. So take care to identify well why you want to get to conduct hydraulic fracturing, and design your hydraulic fracturing job to meet your targets. Simply, we in hydraulic fracturing, we bump with high rate, more than the rate of leak off in this formation. Due to that low leak off in formation, the pressure increase and open fracture in formation. After once the hydraulic fracture open, there is a leak off in formation and continuous during bumping, but we bump with larger rate, so we increase the propagation of hydraulic fracture. Once we shut down, the pressure, the leak off control the system now, so the leak off will be the dominant and the fracture starts to close. If we bump it only a fluid and created a fracture, then shut down, the fracture will completely close and return again to the radial flow better. But to create an effective hydraulic fracturing, we need to put a support or keep the fracture open. What keep the fracture open? Two main types of hydraulic fracturing: probe the fracture and acid fracturing. Probe the fracturing is to put and pump propant in formation, which is propant is like a sand in with high porosity and high permeability in this fracture to keep the fracture open. Or in carbonate, you can use acid to etch the surface of the fracture, and when the fracture close, there is an etched surface in the fracture which make the fracture open during the production. So acid fracturing can't be used without carbonate. So acid fracturing used in carbonate formation, dolomite and calcite, and probe the fracturing can be used with carbonate and sandstone formation and or even shale formation. Also, carbonate can bump probe the fracturing in acid fracturing when there is issue in acid reaction with carbonate. Simply, this is the operation of hydraulic fracturing. We bump a clean fluid to create a fracture, create around 90% of fracture geometry. Then start bombing probant with different concentration with ascending probant concentration to guarantee the placement of this probant in formation. Then flush our well to keep our well clean and minimize the cost of clean out and the flush flush propant from our well and guarantee all our fracturing is filled with propant. That's simply the operation of hydraulic fracturing. Then when we shut down our bumping, the fracture close against the probant that we bumped in formation, as the fluid leak off in formation when we shut down bumps. And that's simply the execution of hydraulic fracturing. to pump a bed, then start propellant ramping after the bed till get the suitable conductivity, then shut down and observe leak off, observe leak off till the closure. So that is some drawing or to understand the concept. We introduce a fracture, information, and fill part of it, most of it, with probant, and using a fracturing fluid. Fracturing fluid, not a clean fluid, due to its properties, as we need to increase its viscosity, we increase the polymer content in this fluid. So there is some fracturing fluid damage in this fracturing fluid, which caused a decrease in the permeability of this probant and the conductivity of this fracture. So when we bump hydraulic fracturing, we bump information probant, and keep in mind, we bump also polymer with fracturing fluid, which causes fracturing fluid damage. Simple terminology of hydraulic fracturing to the length or depth of propagation in the reservoir is called half length, fracture half length, and the height of the fracture is the vertical height of the fracture that cover the bay zone, and the width is the width of fracturing at well bore and decrease with the increase of depth through to the reservoir. Simply, the end of presentation, we will take some notes about the modeling of hydraulic fracturing. Hydraulic fracturing as a geometry, we take care about half fracture half length, fracture height, fracture width, and fracture conductivity. The fracture conductivity is the permeability of probant bag, which for sure the this probant bag that we bombed, so we know how the permeability of this material that we brought from known vendor, so we know the permeability. But what makes the fracture conductivity one of the mysterious concept in hydraulic fracturing is we don't know how the fracture fluid damaged this conductivity. So this permeability, if we multiplied it with depths, with widths of hydraulic fracturing, we can't calculate theoretical fracture conductivity. Is it true? Is it what we bombed information? For sure, we don't know, but we try to estimate with best approach. So due to the fracture fluid damage, due to crushing, when the fracture close against the probant, it crushes amount of this probant, due to a lot of factors which make the fracture conductivity less than what's theoretically calculated. So we need to keep in mind, fracturing fluid is will for sure will create fracture fluid damage. So that make the in a lot of cases hydraulic fracturing lessen the productivity of the well, and we initially bombed hydraulic fracturing to increase the productivity of the well, and to make fracture conductivity relative to the formation, it should be related to the formation. We introduce a concept of dimensionless fracture conductivity, which is fracture conductivity over formation deliverability. Fracture conductivity is a permeability of probant reduced by the fracture fluid damage or crushing or this factors multiplied by width. This divided by the formation of the formation permeability multiplied with by fracture half length. This dimensionless fracture conductivity make the hydraulic fracturing design easier and relative to each reservoir. So we can relate our fracture to be suitable with that reservoir by dimensionless the fracture conductivity. So if we bombed certain amount of probant, the manager asking why the well didn't produce, you should ask yourself a question: what is the dimensionless fracture conductivity for this fracturing? Is it related to your reservoir, which is your permeability and your and the depth of this fracture? What is the dimensionless fracture conductivity? That's how to judge the judge how is your success with hydraulic fracturing. So we have simply in on Earth we have a lot of layers of formation and sedimentation till our depth of our reservoir. This weight of formation and all fluid in it and the lithology create a vertical stress to our reservoir or to on our formation. This due to the limited area of each segment of our reservoir, this vertical stress cause minimum stresses everywhere in horizontal section in horizontal plane. So we can as a simplification, we can simplify the stresses that which is everywhere in each plane to three principal stresses: vertical stresses, minimum horizontal stress, and maximum horizontal stress. So by our assumption, maximum horizontal stress is vertical, is perpendicular to maximum horizontal stress. Minimum horizontal stress and the maximum horizontal stress are perpendicular to each other. And the minimum horizontal and vertical stress is perpendicular to each the plane of minimum and the maximum horizontal stress. So when we bomb hydraulic fracturing, how can the fracture propagate? Fracture propagate again perpendicular to minimum horizontal stress. Like here, like that, what I am talking about, when this is the minimum horizontal stress and this is the maximum horizontal stress, and we when we create a pressure created by rate in this point, it open against minimum horizontal stress, so it will propagate with maximum horizontal stress. And maybe that not an issue in vertical hydraulic fracturing. Any direction may not affect on our production, but in horizontal well, it's really and it's very important issue in hydraulic fracturing, as it affect on how we will drill our well to make the fracture transverse, if we plan to transverse, or longitudinal, if we plan to do it longitudinal. And each type of hydraulic fracturing direction will affect on production. So it's an issue in horizontal well, as it make us decide how can we drill our well most of hydraulic fracturing projects as we hydraulic fracturing, multi-stage hydraulic fracturing in tight formation, we need to create multi-stage hydraulic fracturing to increase the reservoir stimulated volume to produce from this very tight reservoir. So we need larger volume, which is created by transverse fracturing, not longitudinal. Longitudinal may be in higher permeability reservoir, which is we need to bypass this narrow reservoir area and produce from good reservoir. But this, under any condition, fracturing controlled by stress. And we control the drilling based on the fracture propagation that we need to introduce in our well. Fracture propagation, is it linear, planar bi-wing frac like we see in most of books? No, it's not smooth as we read from textbooks. If we have a small amount of fissures in formation, when each fracture and our fracture intersect these fissures, it starts to open and take some fluid, and based on the degree of this fracture, the complexity of fracture network, maybe multiple fracture or complex fracture network. So to understand the fracture geometry and the fracture propagation, let's simplify this concept with net pressure concept. Simply, when we apply hydraulic fracturing to our well, we start to, like we fill a balloon with air. And for simplification, what's create hydraulic fracturing? Our pumps, hydraulic fracturing pump, and hydrostatic pressure. And the fracture propagation is due to the difference between the pressure inside the balloon and the pressure outside the balloon, which in hydraulic fracturing, the pressure inside hydraulic fracturing and the pressure outside hydraulic fracturing, which is minimum horizontal stress. So net pressure is the difference between the fracture propagation pressure inside hydraulic fracturing and the pressure and minimum horizontal stress. And if we have a pinhole in our balloon, it's harder to fill this balloon and stretch this balloon. So this is an example why fracturing in high permeability formation or fracture deformation is hard. So as we need to maintain the net pressure high enough to create a suitable geometry and keep widths open to for placement of probant. For sure, if this distance between the body of balloon and your mouth it's long. If it's longer, it will be harder to fill the balloon due to the friction in this area. And shape of geometry depend on the properties and the pressure between inside and outside the balloon, and the leak of rate if we pump our air or fill the balloon with air and there is a pinhole in this balloon. Also, a basic concept of hydraulic fracturing is what's happening in this balloon when we fill it with air. What happens is tension. So the hydraulic fracturing is a tension process. When we deal with geomechanical concepts, we don't touch UCS as an example, as it hydraulic fracturing is a tension operation to our wheel move. If we have a hole in this balloon, so it will be harder to fill this balloon due to the leak of. So let make if we understand this well, you can understand how the hydraulic fracturing during hypermobility formation or during there is a fracture in your reservoir hard for the hydraulic fracturing operation, because the hypermobility or fracture steal our net pressure. So keeping net pressure high enough for proppant placement is harder for in this cases. You need to keep in mind again, hydraulic fracturing, we bump with rate and the pressure response from formation is in pressure. So to understand the net pressure of hydraulic, understand the net pressure of hydraulic fracturing, as we saw in the simplified example, the net pressure is the pressure inside fracturing minus minimum horizontal stress. So pressure inside the fracture is the same as pressure inside the well, but there is the pressure is lost here in this area due to friction of perforation friction and tortuosity. We'll talk about that later. And this pressure at this point will be the same as pressure at wellhead, but with hydrostatic minus friction. So pressure at wellhead will be if we bump with hydraulic fracturing at, for example, 9,000 psi, so and hydrostatic 2,000 psi. So we have here bottom hole 11,000 psi, and there is a pressure lost due to friction, so it decreased again to 8,000 psi, for example. Then for this pressure to enter the frac, it lost a lot, some frictions due to neural bore friction, due to perforation friction, as it moved from 8 inch well to through small perforation and loss of friction due to this this change in diameter, and there is a loss in friction which make pressure inside the fracture less than the pressure in well bore, and open a fracture against the minimum horizontal stress. And this is net pressure, which is pressure inside the frac minus minimum horizontal stress. So what is still our pressure during fracture propagation? Neural bore friction and perforation friction. As we know, fracture propagation must be against, must be at the direction of direction perpendicular to minimum horizontal stress. And there is a perforation around in all angles of our we have perforation not aligned with this minimum horizontal stress direction, but propagation for sure will realign to suit the perpendicular to minimum horizontal stress. This deviation for the fluid from the direction of perforation to the direction of perpendicular to minimum horizontal stress, which make losses of friction due to called neural bore friction, and due to perforation where there is and due to the friction due to flow in pipe, we have pipe friction. It's for sure it's calculated carefully before hydraulic fracturing job by test called step down تيست. Simply that's the main equation for hydraulic fracturing. In our companies, we hear our fracture surface company or production engineer talk about solution that we can do not to the, get a screen out during bombing. We can increase rate, we can increase viscosity, and take a lot of discussion solution to place the hydraulic fracturing job without any problem. What control the hydraulic fracturing success? This is the main equation. Net pressure mainly consists of two components. The main component is due to our fluid that we pump, which is pressure viscous, which is the part of net pressure controlled by our fracturing fluid. There is another part of net pressure due to the formation properties itself, but it's not an issue for hard formation, which is toughness part of net pressure, so it can be neglected. It controls the tip part of net pressure and depend on the height of reservoir and the toughness of our reservoir. That's the geomechanical concept. So we control hydraulic fracturing propagation using this equation, which is that we control the viscous part of net pressure. We control it by the viscosity of fracturing fluid, the rate of fracturing fluid, and all of this, the rest of parameters are the H0 is the length of our reservoir, height of our reservoir, Young's modulus of reservoir, length of hydraulic fracturing. So to increase the propagation, increase the net pressure, we can increase the viscosity of fracturing fluid, we can increase the bombing rate, that are the controlling parameters that we control during hydraulic fracturing. Hydraulic fracturing is propagation in any reservoir can be controlled by the stress difference between the reservoir and the upper boundary and the lower boundary. If the net pressure more than 50% of the difference between the stress in reservoir and the boundary, it will propagate. And if it increased, this net pressure increased more than 80% of that difference, it will propagate, and as it there is no any boundary. So the main parameter that control hydraulic fracturing propagation to be kept in your reservoir is the stress boundary between the boundary and your reservoir. So when we bump hydraulic fracturing and we succeeded to bump all the problems that we brought on location for hydraulic fracturing to be bumped in formation, we can also understand what happened down there in our reservoir during the hydraulic fracturing propagation by understanding the net pressure. Understanding the net pressure is the concept of fracturing propagation, the main concept of fracturing propagation. If the if we understood what happened with the net pressure, we can understand what happened in our reservoir. The simplest method and the method which is very popular is the Nolte Smith technique, is to pump to draw log log between net pressure and injection and injection time, and understand what happened in each stage in your fracturing For example, if we got if we take a, you can take any data from your company or from or free data from internet, you can make it with your Excel, get net pressure with time and get the slope for each and draw Nolte Smith technique for Nolte Smith for this for your job to understand what happened in this well. For sure, we see the end result of if it succeeded to place the probant or it we got a screen out. But maybe in some wells, when with net pressure started to drop, and as an example, then we must understand there is here in this drop during this time of drop of net pressure in log scale between log time and the log net pressure, we must understand there is a propagation outside our reservoir, and that may be the reason of screen out. So understanding of net pressure and trend with time is a key concept to keep to know what happened in fracture propagation. During the start of any fracture propagation, there is a positive hydraulic fracturing to till the fracture cover all bay zone. Then normal fracture propagation in zero slope. There is the control. Now it's so the width is open and the fracture propagation in length. So it's good, but at any time, if the probant started to fill the frac and no fracture propagation, we will get tip screen out, which is screen out mean probant doesn't propagate inside the frac. It stop and increase the pressure of net pressure. And if we got pressure slope, net pressure slope one, it's a signal or indication for tip screen out. If the slope is more than one, it will bore neural bore area, neural bore screen out. If there is a drop in net pressure, that means the pressure, our fracture propagated in a lower stress zone or propagated in height, or there is no barrier above or below our reservoir. So we based on what we see at each stage, we can understand how the hydraulic fracturing propagation. This is some indication or studies about Nolte Smith pressure plot. The concept of screen out is probant can't propagate deep in our fracture and stopped, and the width is not sufficient enough for to bump a lot of probant in our hydraulic fracturing. There is some basic concept of about hydraulic fracturing propagation. It's a very large topic to talk about for only 50 minutes. So I think we can stop here. It's some basic concept about hydraulic fracturing and the propagation of hydraulic fracture. Thanks.
Thank you, Engineer Muhammad, for this interesting session. I will send the feedback form on the chat. Please all make sure to fill it so we can always
Okay.
Be Can better I... and fulfill your needs. Now, if anyone please.
Can I take questions from
you? Have section? Any question? If you can ask, you can drop it in the Q&A. Yes. Sure. I will read them for you. So improve the permeability.
Sorry, I can't continue.
Can fracturing improve the permeability?
No, fracturing doesn't increase the permeability. It increases the contact area and increase the widths to bypass neural pore damage. But still, the formation permeability, it is the control point of our production. So it doesn't increase the permeability. It creates an area which can we bump probant in it. We can bump probant in it, which is higher permeability than formation. So it doesn't change the permeability of reservoir, but it creates another both for production with permeability higher than this low permeability of reservoir.
Okay. Another question is, can we pump the frac fluid and the propant at the same stage?
Propant bumped information carried with the fracturing fluid. We bump fracturing fluid to create the fracture geometry and place the probant in formation. So one of the main parameters of fracturing fluid is the carrying capacity of probant. Can it carry the probant to the desired depth in formation or not? So fracturing fluid carry the probant at the same time during a hydraulic fracturing operation.
Okay, thank you. Another question is, how can we optimize the use of polymers in the fracturing hydraulic fluid so that it won't damage the wellbore?
One of the main rules of frac engineer or location or subsurface production engineer is to control the QQC job and pump the right amount of breaker, which is break that polymer to the lower concentration to decrease the damage. So during the bumping the hydraulic fracture job and during design and execution of this hydraulic fracture job, we bump a breaker chemical, which may be enzyme or oxidizer, to break that polymers to minimize the damage. But for sure, there is a damage from any fracture fluid. Okay.
Okay. Another, but please explain increased density and is the fracture plane feasible?
Sorry, I can't. Is it, sorry?
Okay. Is fracturing
visible?
Fluoropropane feasible? Yes.
Your voice is breaking. I'll read the question. The question is, Engineer Muhammad, how does hydraulic fracturing increase the seismicity and is fracking using fluoropropane feasible?
It increases seismicity because, especially in high fracture activity, like there is, like we, if we have a well with 100 stage frac and there is a 24 hours per day, 7 days fracturing operation in an area, and each fracture operation have a lot of noise due to fracturing fluid, the fracturing itself, the fracturing rock at very high high level of activity, it may increase seismicity around this area. And not this problem is mainly observed in shale gas development, where is there is a lot of hydraulic fracturing, and this hydraulic fracturing is a very complicated propagation due to complex network fracture propagation, and each fracture propagation due to the fracturing itself at each point, it causes seismicity due to the high level of activity. But in our conventional operation, it's not observed. So it's not a, an issue with our reservoirs.
Okay. Second question, what is the most preferable rock formation for most efficient hydraulic fracturing?
There is no clear answer for this question. Hydraulic fracture, it should design based on two main parameters, which is two essential parameters to be understood well. The first parameter is permeability of reservoir. The second one, the drainage area of your reservoir. If you design the hydraulic fracturing to meet this parameter as well, and you understand how this parameters for your reservoir, and that parameter are right, and you understand it well, so you can design hydraulic fracturing to be the most efficient or most optimum one. The problem of for us to as a hydraulic fracturing engineers to there is always uncertainty of any data. Permeability, we have no one in industry care about permeability until it comes to frack. Drainage area of any well it's subject to be there is uncertainty, a great uncertainty between reservoirs, between uncertainty between the data. So that's the main problem. But any rock can be suitable for any hydraulic fracturing if we have this data with low level of uncertainty. Okay.
Okay. Next question. How does the process of large scale hydraulic fracturing differ for granite for EGS from that of the limestone for AOR?
For limestone, there is option. There is an option for acid fracturing. As a EOR method, but granite, I think the due to low reaction rate with acid, maybe probed fracturing may be more efficient than acid fracturing. So also the formation lithology itself is not issue for hydraulic fracturing, but the main parameter here is permeability and drainage area. So, and if we have carbonate, calcite, limestone, or dolomite, we can select acid fracturing. As fracturing need some lab reports and lab tests for acid fracturing, like acid etching test, acid solubility test, and there is a lot of lab tests which make acid fracturing less effective than less effective than probed fracturing. So probed fracturing is the main, always the main selection, but maybe in some formation on, or in some lithology, probant probed fracturing.
Okay. One last question. What's the differences in detail between the hydrofracking used in enhanced geothermal system, EGS, with that in enhanced oil gas development?
Hydraulic fracture, yeah. No difference between maybe enhanced geothermal system, maybe due to bombing probant, probed fracturing. So we start with bed and starting increase the bed, the probant concentration till the end. And in enhanced oil and gas development, also based on the target of hydraulic fracturing. So maybe enhanced oil and gas, maybe in carbonate or in limestone, maybe not a lot of difference. It's due to the what is the target of this fracturing.
Thank you. One last question. What make the fracture open?
In what make the fracture open? Probant and probe defracturing, and acid etching result in acid frac acid frac operation. Can you see my screen? Probant that we bombed in probe defracturing make the fracture open, and the acid etching on surface of due to acid reaction with between acid and the carbonate make the fracture in acid fracture open. So we have two tools to keep the fracture open: the probant and the acid reaction with the formation with carbonate in acid fracture, which make surface not smooth, and when the fracture close, it will not close against each other, and there is a fracture in this when the fracture close. Okay. Okay.
Okay, thank you. We have another question. Between vertical and horizontal frac processes, the leak off rate is greater at which?
Oh, as we talked during the presentation, the fracture propagate perpendicular to minimum stress. So if the vertical stress is the minimum of the three stresses, is less than minimum horizontal stress and the maximum horizontal stress, the propagation will be horizontal fracturing. That observed in shallow fracturing. If we bombed hydraulic fracturing at 500 feet, the stress, the vertical stress will be less than minimum horizontal stress and the maximum horizontal stress, and the propagation will be horizontal, like not a vertical fracturing. Vertical fracturing in deep formation. So leak of rate is controlled by the permeability. So it's horizontal or vertical fracturing, the leak of doesn't matter between the vertical or horizontal, but it's controlled by the permeability of the formation itself. Is it high perm, so high leak off rate, or low perm, or low leak off rate? But generally, more deep, more the less permeability. So we can, but it's not general rule, but it depends on the permeability of the formation.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Engineer Muhammad, for your fruitful session. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. You can find the feedback form link at the chat. We hope that you can fill it so we can be better in our next services. We are looking forward to seeing you again in upcoming courses and webinars. Thank you for joining us.